Hi, this is Joseph Rubens of the NHTV University of Applied Sciences. This is the Organizational Behavior course, and today we are going to talk about structuring. Structuring is very important because we notice when we look around that we, as humans, we structure things. We structure our day, we structure our organizations, we structure processes. Now, when this structuring is going on, it is important to always ask ourselves, why do we structure? Because there are functional reasons of structuring, and unfortunately, there are also quite many dysfunctional reasons for structuring. So let's first think about the functional reasons. And while I was reflecting about this, there were actually three reasons that I came up with that would make sense to structure. So one requirement would be to make life easy. For example, I look at my washing machine and I look how it works and it makes my life easier. Put in the wash, press a few buttons, and things start happening. It's definitely making life easier than from the days that mostly women still have to spend hours and hours doing everything by hand. So that's a functional reason to structure something. Another functional reason is we structure because we want to make life beautiful. An example is a piece of music. Beautiful pieces of music have a particular structure. And there's all sorts of structures invented over the ages, but there needs to be something. If it's pure chaos, pure noise, most of the time we don't enjoy listening to it. Except if we're insane, maybe. And structuring is also useful to organize your mind. Every second of the day, thoughts are jumping up and down in our heads. If they jump too much and they make us act on them, we literally turn crazy. So those are functional reasons to structure. But unfortunately, there are also many dysfunctional reasons for structuring. And the reasons I would give for that would be one, neurosis, a false sense of certainty. And when you look at your own life, you will notice that you have particular habits. For example, when you wake up in the morning, you wake up at a particular time. When you wake up in the morning, you first go and get a shower, or not. Or you first get a cup of coffee, or not. Or you need to do some exercises. And the one day when this routine is being interrupted, and you need to do it differently, this often makes you feel awkward, sometimes even anxious. So it seems like we structure our day to give ourselves a certain sense of certainty. I call it a false sense of certainty because there's nothing certain about what you're doing. It's just something that you feel comfortable with. A second reason for structuring, which is dysfunctional, is an unquestioned habit. Well, we do it this way because we have always done it this way. For example, in the British military, there was a habit until recently that every time some heavy gunfire was shot, the person who was going to pull the plug actually took a few steps backwards, raising his left hand. Maybe it was his right hand, but at least he was raising a hand. Now, cute, interesting. Of course, one day, somebody asked the question, why do we do this? Is this some bizarre form of yoga? Well, why do we do this? They had to go back into British military history until the early 20th century, late 19th century, when the British military still had a cavalry with horses. And in those days, there was always somebody who had to hold the horse, and before shooting heavy gunfire, this person had to step back with these horses, because if he didn't do so, then the horses would get scared and run away. So an old habit involving horses was continued for decades and decades and decades until somebody asked the question, why do we do this? And if it doesn't make sense anymore today, do it differently. But this we will always come across. So I'm also inviting you, the listener and the student, think for yourself. Are we structuring for the right reasons, for functional reasons, or are we doing so for dysfunctional reasons? I love this slide. For me, this slide means that books or theories or best practices or examples from the past, when they're useful, they are like bridges to help us, humanity, move forward to an ever brighter future. So when structuring is functional, we are moving ahead. But when structuring becomes dysfunctional, we might as well throw away this book because it doesn't help. So let me give you a few more examples of structuring. Some of them are personal ones, others are organizational ones. Let's start with the personal part. So to make life easy. Well, think about email, the Outlook. There is a beauty in Outlook Express. I mean, no, I do have an interesting life, but when you look at Outlook Express, you notice that it makes life easy. It's not just a bunch of emails where in-out concept is all together and you have no clue what is where, but it's actually there's an inbox and there's an outbox, and you can make folders with your documents, and there's a trash can. You know, it makes life easy. Of course, the moment they start to do all sorts of silly updates that I have to relearn how to use my email system, then of course it becomes dysfunctional. But currently, it is still easy. At our school, we have systems for goal setting called SMART goals. And I think it was called specific, measurable, achievable, I forgot, and T something with time. But anyways, this model helps students to clearly set their goals and make them practical. So it's a little mental trick that makes your life easy. The same with a star system. The same with exam regulations or laws. I'm quite happy that we have laws for driving cars in this country. And I'm quite happy that most people understand these laws and also respect them, because else we would have many more deaths. I know of countries, I mean, I don't want to use a stereotype, but I do want to use a stereotype. When I was studying in Italy for a year, I was going on a bicycle, and during that year, I saw myself 8 accidents occurring. And very often it was people, mostly car drivers, not respecting the regulations. Anyways, time planning. Well, some planning systems, some agendas are really there to make life easy. Of course, if you spend hours and hours on your time planner and you're not doing anything else, then it becomes dysfunctional. A second reason for structuring, which I was already mentioned, to make life beautiful or creative. Well, music, good songs have wonderful structure. Art, great painting, sculptures, but also something like accounting. Although I'm not an accountant, when I do my accounts and it's all clear and nicely structured, I feel a sense of beauty. This has made things easy for me. And as I said before, helping you to structure your mind, for example, with a good time plan. Now, there are also organizational ways for structuring. One of these people who was concerned with structure was an American, Frederick Taylor. And what did Frederick Taylor do? He looked at laborers in the late 19th century. He looked at the way they were working in steel factories. And his idea was these people are doing this extremely inefficiently. They're taking so much time to do something that I believe could be done a lot more efficiently. And what this involves is actually restructuring their labor. They don't have to work harder, but they have to work smarter in a certain way. So Taylor's concern was with efficiency. And whether we like his system or not nowadays, that's another story. But he really wanted actually to give labor and management a better result and labor also a better pay, actually. But what did he do? Well, he observed. He looked at how people were working. He observed. He checked them with his watch, how much time a specific task took. And he cut tasks into little bits and pieces. And then he said, well, maybe we can rearrange this in a more interesting way. So, to tell you a few things about Taylorism, he separated acting from thinking. So, in the past, laborers would design their work. This time, an outside observer would look at it and then say, hey, you can do it differently. He had something called division of labor. How do you understand division of labor? Well, it's by saying, let's cut a task into small pieces. For example, if I am a student, I am studying for an exam, then task number one would be buy the book or get the book. Task number two, read page 1 to 5. Number three could be revise or make a summary of 1 to 5. Number four could be sit together with a friend and have him ask some questions. So you're taking a task and you're dividing it in bits and pieces. And often this would also mean that a particular person would do a particular task. This was also called scientific management. In the days of Taylor, there was this whole amazement about science. And so he had a fundamental to say this makes sense, this is scientific. So he had job design, and he would work on what is called short repetitive work cycles. What this means is you have 5 minutes of, for example, cleaning the table. Well, after 5 minutes of that, you have 30 seconds of walking from the table to the door. Then you have another task. So short, repetitive work cycles. And he had detailed, prescribed task sequences. Some of us still go to fast food restaurants like McDonald's or Pizza Hut. And when you notice how the people are working, they have very detailed and prescribed task sequences. There is a particular way of preparing a hamburger that somebody back in the US has studied is the most efficient way, and everybody should do it that way. As I said before, there's a separation of task conception, so thinking about it, and task execution. Somebody supposedly smart tells you how you should do things. And here, motivation is mostly based on economic rewards, on money. Let's now watch a short video on Taylorism.